Welcome back to Generals and Napoleon. In this episode, we welcome back our good friend, Marcus Cribb.
Good evening. Thanks very much for having me for round two as such.
Yeah, definitely round two. You remember a few episodes back, we had Marcus on for the Duke of Wellington episode. And if you haven't been to the website, Marcus, could you tell them the website that we like to promote on these episodes?
So I've got a few things going. Obviously, I always want to shout out to Napoleonic and Revolutionary War Graves Charity, of which I'm one of a few of the trustees. Yep. And so we're online and on social and that. But I've got my own stuff that I do mostly on Twitter, MCRIP History, and I put a few items on dukeofwellington.org.
Dukeofwellington.org. Yeah,
that's my website.
Yep. Love that one. But yeah, the charity is a good one as well. Which I am a member, and I recommend all of my followers.
Thank you.
Yeah. All my followers, go ahead and join that charity. It's a great group. Okay, so we talked about the Duke of Wellington last time we had Marcus on the show. So I figured we'd talk about, would it be considered his right-hand man, General Hill?
Well, already that's a little bit of debate. We'd mentioned a few last time, didn't we?
We did.
We got Hill, Beresford, and Graham as kind of some of Wellington's like top lieutenants, and I think of Hill as kind of Wellington's right-hand man. A few would probably say it was probably Beresford, and at times there was certainly Graham, Lord Lindock. But to me, I've got a bit of a soft point for Hill. This is Rowland Hill, first Viscount, and he's a bit of a favourite of mine.
Yeah, I was looking at the history of him, and it looked like in terms of independent command, the best way I could associate it to all my Grand Army followers, he reminded me a lot of Marshal Lon. Like Napoleon would give Marshal Lon an assignment and he didn't have to worry about it getting done. It would just get done. And that's kind of what General Hill reminded me of.
Yeah. Hill gets a few independent commands and also gets some really independent, really important independent postings. And I think that's why I tend to put that he was probably one of his top guys. And he also appears again at Waterloo. For me, the best thing about him is his men like him. And I think that speaks volumes.
Yeah, we'll get into why he was such a fan favorite of his men, but let's talk about his early life. Born in 1772, and was it a noble family he was born into?
It was a noble family, a baronet, so that's like the lowest level, so that's a sir, a knight, up in Shropshire. So for me, the north of England, but kind of the North Midlands in England, and lots of big land, but not one of like the big rich families, the Hill family. That's really kind of going to be known and they have lots of land and quite big houses because land happens to be cheaper up there, but not one of the big influential families that we know of.
Right. Okay. And he was the fourth child and second son in the family.
That's right.
And he was educated at the King's School. Was that a famous school back in the day?
It's one of the bigger ones up kind of in the Midlands. Yeah. So he had his normal education. And then commissioned into the 38th foot after leaving school.
That's so around 1790 we're talking.
1790. He was born 1772 in Shropshire. Right. So quite quickly into the army. What's that, about 18 years old?
18 years, yeah.
Which is quite normal. So the second son's not really going to inherit all the money. The first one's the eldest son. The eldest son inherits everything.
You know, that's,
they survive, and the second son's basically going to have to go off and make their own.
That's interesting. Kind of like the Duke of Wellington. He was the second son, so he had to go and make it off on his own.
Right. He wasn't going to inherit the titles and bits, so he had to work his own way. Rowland Hill's kind of like that. He has to go and do his own. And the army's a good trade. So not only can they learn, you know, something to do, a career, working something that's socially acceptable in Georgian society, wearing the uniform, serving your country, but there is the chance of advancement, going up the ranks, earning glory and riches and fame and that kind of thing.
Yeah, and it looks like he was promoted pretty quickly at, you know, lieutenant 1791 and captain in 1793.
Yes, probably, and I don't want to make any assumptions here because it's not noted, he probably purchased his way up. Which was the system of the British Army at the time. Not a good system, really. If you had the money, I think it was after 1 to 2 years service, depending on rank, you could basically buy your way up. And there was ways to actually kind of twist that and go up quicker. But that was kind of normal. You do a bit of time at the bottom. And sure, he did a little bit of time. And then going up to captain by 1793.
Got it. And then from there, he tastes his first defeat, really, I guess, in the Siege of Toulon, Napoleon's first major victory.
Yeah, and as far as I'm aware, it's his first action. You know, he crosses Napoleon's path at Toulon quite quickly.
Mm-hmm. And yeah, you know, that was obviously, you know, Napoleon wasn't in full command there, but he was a big part of that victory there. And he served under, who was it? The guy who surrendered to both George Washington and Napoleon.
O'Hara, I believe that was.
Yeah, O'Hara, that's right.
O'Hara, so yeah, he had the, let's say the honor of both Washington and Napoleon's surrender.
Yeah.
And Viscount Hill, as he became, actually holds, took the dispatches back to England, which is normally a position of somebody who's done quite well or one of honor. And he takes that back and then gives that to basically the army headquarters in London. Normally that comes with promotion or some sort of reward is going on with there. So there's probably a reason that he was singled out for that after Toulon.
Okay. And I think this is interesting, this next bit, you know, he's promoted to lieutenant colonel a year later, which again, I think that's as far as you can buy your promotions.
That's correct. Yeah. So you can buy your way up to lieutenant colonel, which is commanding officer of a regiment, so a battalion.
Mm-hmm.
And after that, you do actually have to be picked out and promoted up on merit after.
Right. That. Which is interesting because it took him 6 years then to get his next promotion. So he had to really earn it.
Had to really earn it, had to do his time, and he does spend, you know, a fair bit of that overseas. His next posting is to the Egyptian expedition.
Yeah, let's talk about that briefly. You know, I think Napoleon was gone by this point. He was back in France, but Napoleon had, a garrison station there under Bendel.
So this is one of the controversial ones about Napoleon. He heads back and leaves quite a lot of his men in Egypt. Arguably either as a rear guard or he's kind of left them and gone off to his own political ambitions, hasn't he, really?
Right.
And the British expedition lands at Akabir Bay and lands by boat. There's some skirmishing on the sand, quite an interesting action because they row ashore and then are fighting the sand dunes. And then we're pushing inland and fighting the French in Egypt with all the kind of complicated local politics that's going on as well.
Right.
And this is a force that's been brought together from England, actually some troops from the Mediterranean theatre, some from India, and it's quite a big force under Ralph Abercrombie. And no relation to Abercrombie and Fitch, as far as I'm aware. And they, something that's just as a sort of side note, this is one of the first examples that most of the force that are going out there actually inoculated. They're all given a vaccine, I believe, for smallpox before they mm-hmm. go en masse. Mm-hmm. So there's some modern thinking going on as far back as 1801.
Yeah, and I don't want people to think like, you know, the French that were left there were just a bunch of chumps. I mean, there were some good soldiers there. General Desailles and future Marshal Dubu was still there. So it wasn't going to be an easy fight, even with Napoleon out of there.
It wasn't an easy fight. I think the British had some setbacks in that campaign. Certainly wasn't easy. I would say that some, definitely not all, of the British troops there were a little bit second rate. Mm-hmm. There are some units that don't always shine themselves in glory, and they were having to kind of make brigades out of different units. Mm-hmm. But there also were some like kind of first battalions out there. So anyone who's a little bit unfamiliar with the British system, you typically started to have at this time first battalions, which were meant to be for their overseas service, and the second battalion of the same regiment. So for Hill at this time, he was commanding the 90th Regiment of Foot. And they tend to normally have two battalions. One's meant to be the depot back in the UK and provide release, and the first battalion at overseas. Now, normally, because they get so much like demand on them, sometimes you end up with the second battalion going out, and there's a bit of rivalry between them.
Got it.
Want to make a podcast? Spotify's got a platform that lets you make one super easily, then distribute it everywhere, and even earn money. All one place for free. It's called Spotify for Podcasters, and here's how it works. Spotify for Podcasters lets you record and edit podcasts right from your phone or computer. So no matter what your setup is like, you can start creating today. Then you can distribute your podcast to Spotify and everywhere else podcasts are heard. Video podcasts are also available. With Spotify for Podcasters, you can earn money in a variety of ways, including ads and podcast subscriptions. And best of all, it's totally free with no catch. Ever since I discovered Spotify for Podcasters, I've really enjoyed the ease of use and the distribution ability of this platform.
And then I guess at some point he was wounded in the head by a musket ball, General Hill. But he wasn't a general at this time, Colonel Hill.
Colonel Hill, out in Egypt as well. And I don't think it was a serious wound, but you think that, you know, a musket ball actually hits it, you know, range is about 100 yards.
Yeah.
So that's a piece of lead flying at quite close range.
Yeah.
It's still going to cause a bit of a dent.
Yeah. I don't want a musket ball anywhere near my head. Yeah.
No, 100 yards or 200 yards. First stay away.
Right. But his efforts and, you know, Abercrombie's as well, the French are eventually driven out of Egypt, correct?
They are. It's not an easy campaign because they are fighting in, you know, difficult circumstances. They're in the desert. It's not somewhere many of the generals and the troops certainly don't have the experience in doing so. And it's mostly kind of concentrated as far as they can to the coastal towns going up and down and securing those key ports. Mm-hmm. So we've got that kind of sphere of influence in the Mediterranean, which when you think about, we're just kind of pre-Trafalgar building up to, and it's really where Britain wants to have its trade and its influence going overseas, linking up India, the Cape Colony, which is basically South Africa, back to the UK. Mm-hmm. And our allies, you know, there and overseas.
So after the French are driven out of Egypt, I believe Hill, where does his eyes he takes? I know he gets promoted general shortly after, but he's not in Europe battling Napoleon just yet.
Not yet. Not until the first part of the Peninsular War back in La Rilesa. So there's a couple of years in the middle, where I believe he heads home. He's really keen rider, fox hunter on his hounds, and you know, he has the social scene of Shropshire, effectively.
Yeah, let's talk about that fox hunting thing. I read somewhere that him being an avid fox hunter might have developed his keen eye for ground. Do you think that has something to do with like how well he did as a general?
Yeah, I'm not a rider or definitely not a hunter, but I can kind of see that these people, Wellington's famous for having an eye of the ground. Mm-hmm. And it's anything you can kind of do, get the countryside, get that appreciation of, in this case, where his quarry, his prey, might be hiding as a fox in the scrub. Mm-hmm. And he's also going to spend a lot of time on the horse, heading over lots of countryside. And yeah, I certainly find that these people, they tend to have what we call ground appreciation in the army. Mm-hmm. And they can know where you can hide people, where you can move people. Mm-hmm. And Hill seems to have this. I think probably part of his like kind of, you say, like rural upbringing. He spends a lot of time in the saddle.
Right, right. So jumping ahead in our story a little bit, you know, we'll just move to the Peninsular War, which I believe really got going 1807, 1808, when Napoleon basically takes over Portugal and then from there takes over Spain, correct?
Yes, yeah. He kind of, General Junot marches into Portugal and then he kind of puts the king and the prince regent of, or the crown prince of Spain under house arrest, and that starts the Dos de Mayo uprising, and there grows the Peninsular War really from there. Hill's there from the beginning. Mm-hmm. I believe it was Wellington, as he was then Arthur Wellesley, writes a letter to Hill when he's got his command in Cork and they're wondering where to go. And he writes to Hill to ask him, you know, is he basically coming with him? And he hopes he will. And he does. He gets brigade command. So above the regiment, you've got the brigade level. And Hill goes out there. And he's at the first major battle, the Battle of Rilesa, August 1808. Mm-hmm.
And I just want to appreciate, though, like, you know, he's still learning, although he's a general, he's learning under two of the greats, right? I mean, the future Duke of Wellington and Sir John Moore.
Yes. When after Rilesa, he ends up on Sir John Moore's infamous retreat to Corunna. That's right at the northwest of Spain. Yep. After his Rilesa, then there's Vimero, the Treaty of Cintra following Vimero, yep. And Wellington and the other two generals are brought back to the UK. Hill stays out there with his unit and follows Sir John Moore into Spain, which is only just saved by a bit of intelligence from a chap called Major Waters. Just about managed to get away, marching all the way, basically from just inside the Spanish border to the Spanish coast in winter, which is, really devastating.
Yeah, I read about that. Napoleon had this grand plan to trap them, and I think some piece of intelligence that he was sending to Soult or something got intercepted, and it was just in the nick of time that Moore was able to get to the coast.
I believe it was one of those things that's like almost countdown clock in a James Bond film. It was like seconds away. the dispatch rider with it was captured by the Spanish, I believe. Mm-hmm. And I think he was basically going to be hung up by his ankles in the town centre. Mm-hmm. And Major Waters, general in the end, John Waters, paid for the intelligence off the Spanish. And takes it to Sir John Moore, saying, look, this trap's coming in. And I focus on Waters because he's the one who finds the boats at the Battle of Porto.
That's right.
I say, inverted commas, my battle that I focus on.
We can jump to that in here in just a sec. So just at the Battle of Corunna, just to wrap up for everyone, the British are able to basically fight a good rearguard action, keep Marshal Soult at bay while they escape on their ships, correct?
That's it. It's almost like a bit of a Dunkirk, but rather than just everyone waiting on it's the quayside in Corunna. It's a harbour town. They've trudged all this way north, taking their wives and their supplies with them.
Wow. Okay. So from there, just moving the story along, the British obviously evacuate, but then they come back. And in our last episode on Duke of Wellington, we talked about the Battle of Oporto, where they routed Marshal Soult there, but it seems like Hill was one of the ones who led that surprise attack, correct?
Yes, so this is Porto again. I won't labor it too much. but Hill's now given another brigade. He's actually got one of the chief brigades of Wellington's unit, and it's his brigade that chosen to go across. There's actually one of Uxbridge's, of Waterloo fame, one of his brothers actually goes over and leads the main unit, but he's actually shot in the arm and loses his arm in the battle. So it's quite unlucky brothers there. So it's Hill's unit that go over, principally from the 3rd Regiment of Foot, known as the Buffs, along with the 66th and 48th. And we know there's some German riflemen from the 5th, 60th, at least one that goes over and fight off the French advances from the 17th and the 70th. Attacks on the north bank of Porto. Mm-hmm. And so it's Hill's units that are doing that. During the advance to Porto, he's actually given one of his first independent commands by Wellington, and he goes across the coast. So Wellington spreads his troops out. He sends Beresford on a big, wide northeast unit, sweeping round with his Portuguese, and they hope to pick up some more Portuguese militia and expand the force and then do a blocking motion. Mm-hmm. The first part goes really well, but they're not able to block Soult's retreat.
Right.
And Hill goes on the coast and crosses like a lagoon in boats. Mm-hmm. So that's independent command for Hill as well.
Yeah, for sure. And, Marshal Soult obviously has to evacuate very quickly. He marches up north to Marshal Ney. And then from there, like we talked about in the Duke of Wellington episode, Wellington decides instead to kind of drive into the heart of Spain towards Talavera, correct?
Talavera. So, Hill's then increased his force to, he's then a divisional commander at Talavera. Mm-hmm. And it's his unit then that is the famous night attack. Hopefully you're kind of aware of this one.
Yes, yes.
It all goes a bit wrong. Some of Hill's unit, they're put on this hill above Talavera, and they think they're in reserve, so they're not the front line. So they only put out like a few sentries, whereas actually they're the front line and they should have out like pickets, it's like sentries in force.
Right.
They don't do it, and on come the French night attack, and they manage to get basically past those sentries and into the units. Hill rides out in the middle of the night, and actually Hill is grabbed by a Frenchman, and there's a bit of a scuffle, and he manages to get away.
Mm. Yeah, I read this is the first occasion on which he supposedly swore.
That's one of the things I love, and I know I'm probably not the same as Hill in many ways. He's one of these people that I'd probably get on better with him than Wellington, but we're very different. He doesn't drink and he doesn't swear.
And
this is one of the two that he apparently swears out loud.
Is that just because he's from a noble family, or just that he's just that restrained in himself and that even?
I think it's because he's restrained. I think, especially the drinking, the noble families definitely put away the wine and the claret and the parties. And I imagine when they're away from their peers and their ladies, they would swear like troopers, especially, you know, kind of a men's only culture away on campaign.
Right.
And things are going to be rough, but apparently this is one of the only two times that he swears.
All right. Well, we'll get to the second one here in a minute, but, overall story of Talavera, by morning though, things have kind of regained, you know, they've regained the situation and they're able to fight off Marshal Victor and his troops.
Yes, across the plains just north of the town. It's a difficult victory. It's a really bloody victory. And this is the one where the grass sets fire and lots of the wounded are scorched and killed in the flames afterwards as well.
Yeah, that's tragic. Yeah, that was a messy battle. But from there, he, you know, moving ahead in the story, he has to retreat back towards Portugal, just I think for supply reasons and just so he doesn't get, I guess, enveloped by the size of the French army.
Yeah, and this is always the problem Wellington's got in the Peninsular War, that he's got to rely upon having won the support of the Spanish, which he doesn't really have to the full extent during the Talavera campaign. It's where Moore is unseated, really. And the relationship with the Spanish is always difficult. And two, the French army is always bigger than his because they are out there putting down the insurrection and the guerrilla war.
Right.
And if they can bring themselves to bear at any one time, he's got to move back because there's no point fighting a battle that he knows he's going to lose.
Right, right. It almost seems like a chessboard where he's like a knight and just move towards the queen and then back towards his own lines. And you know,
there's a lot of that going on and moving those pieces into place.
Yeah. So jumping ahead, he 1810, 1811, he fights Hill does against Marshal Massena at the Battle of, and I'll let you say the words. It's a tough one.
So he fights at the Battle of Bussaco, or Bussaco, depending on your pronunciation. There's a Portuguese, the lovely Portuguese inflection. And this is the one on the mountain ridge, amazing Sierra. So this like long mountain. Honestly, if you get a chance to see a battlefield, this is one just kind of blows your minds because it's so steep.
Yeah. And in 1812, he after they push Massena away and they, move back into Spain, they help recapture Madrid, correct?
A little bit later.
Yep.
But yes, he helped recapture Madrid. And in the intervening time, Hill was given another independent command to kind of watch the siege at Badajoz. And this is quite an important time that he's given, I think it's a strong division of men to kind of watch that siege and act as a blocking. And it's during this time that he leads, it's relatively small battle in the scale of the Peninsular War, but he leads a raid or a battle, and I'm going to butcher my Spanish here, but Arroyo de los Molinos.
Yes.
Up in the mountains.
Molinos. Yeah, yeah. I was reading about that against, I think, General Girard on the French side. Yeah.
Yes, yeah, General Girard, and he's holding this kind of mountain area. And Hill kind of gets the drop on him and goes in.
Yeah, I was reading about that. I guess Gerard's sentries, there was a hailstorm the night before and they had their backs turned so they wouldn't be like, you know, getting pelted with hail. And that's the direction that the British charged in from.
They charge in, I think, led by Highlanders with fixed bayonets. They've pushed out. Hill pushes out his army onto two flanks. And Gerard and his men who escape actually literally running up those mountains. And that's where the British kind of reached towards the bottom of and don't give the full pursuit. But yeah, they capture some of the drums, famously, of the French, and some guns as well.
Yeah,
with really few losses.
Yeah, let's pause for a sec here and talk about his nickname, which I think is interesting. And I think that's why his men went above and beyond for him.
So his nickname is Daddy Hill, which feels a bit weird when you just say it by itself.
Right.
But yeah, it's a term of endearment. You know, there was General Robert Crawford, Black Bob Crawford, who was known for his bad temper. And this is why I think I quite like Rowland Hill. You know, his men are giving him a you know, you can give your boss effectively any nickname you want behind his back, can't you?
Right.
So long as he doesn't find out. But they're calling him Daddy Hill, and I think everyone, this word gets round about this kind of time. It's a term of endearment, and a good one too.
Do you have some examples of his courteous behavior, or how he treated his men?
I love to see the statistics. I think he was one of these ones that he wasn't actually known for the flogging.
Mm-hmm.
Crawford's famously tried to flog and shout and have this temper. But no, it was more his kind of general demeanor that he would look after his men, make sure they were fed and give them actual... there were some examples where he actually made sure out of his own kind of pocket he would feed the men. Mm-hmm. I think there was one time that he kind of fed people who gave him like letters in his headquarters rather than just dismissing them.
Mm-hmm.
Which is quite an important one. Yeah. He tried to make sure his men were paid on time, and he was really courteous to them.
Yeah.
And that's, you know, from a general to a private soldier, when you extend that with a Georgian society 200 years ago, you're talking aristocracy to peasantry, basically, or the working class, that goes a long way. And all of a sudden, they're feeling more like being human.
Right.
Not being just a name and a number. They've actually got their own identity under.
Right. And that makes other men want to serve in I would imagine, your division. Like, wow, that guy really takes care of his men.
Yeah. I think if you had the opportunity, you'd be like, okay, I'll work for him. I'd love to go to work under him rather than over there where it's a bit more tougher.
Right. For sure. So moving back into our story, after 1812, they capture Madrid. And then the battles of Vitoria, he's again integral, correct?
Yeah, at Vitoria, he leads one of the, I think they call it a column, but effectively attacking divisions. So this is enveloping around Vitoria onto the town itself, and they're pushing across many different vital crossing points over the river, across the bridges, and fighting in and fighting and pushing on. Mm-hmm. He's basically one of the three chief kind of columns that are going in on that area. Mm-hmm. And that's going to be starting to lead on to make the main campaign, effectively, that will then push towards France. They know at this stage, but it's really important, actually, Vitoria. Again, we mentioned in the last podcast, but Wellington unfairly recognised as being a defensive general.
Right.
Vitoria, Wellington and his men on the attack against, well, Joseph Bonaparte, really.
Yeah, and Jourdan, Marshal Jourdan, yeah. From there, though, I think the attack gets pressed on to the Pyrenees, right, which is the mountain range that separates really Spain and France.
That's it. So it eventually ends up in France. It's really strange that the Peninsular War ends up in south of France. we don't call it the Pyrenees and Pyrenees campaign for nothing.
Right.
And so the Pyrenees campaign is a really difficult one without a very detailed map, because it's against quite a long length of the Pyrenees, which is dramatic scenery up the mountains, and effectively a hill, sometimes independently, with is actually like kind of pushing into almost a core size now up from division.
Mm-hmm.
Has got some independent command, and he's going on the attack as well, as well as Wellington's general orders to kind of like take France.
Yeah, and I read that his work in December 1813 was his finest performance in the defense of Saint-Pierre.
Defense of Saint-Pierre, he's kind of doing counterattacks and holding the lines with our friend again, Marshal Soult. In this kind of time, he's leading the defense of the Franco-Spanish border. But then we get into December in the winter, and you think both sides are fighting up these mountains and these passes in winter, in their woolen clothes and hobnail boots. And it's at the Battle of Neve on the 13th of December that he takes thousands of men across a river. It's got a little bridge, and the bridge breaks, and there's apparently the river's really swollen, and Soult does a counterattack. And just then, when Hill thinks it's all lost, that's the second time he swears.
Yeah, I read the quote that, Hill was, quote, seen at every point of danger and rallied regiments in person. And as you mentioned, he was even heard to swear. And the numbers were, he was outnumbered 2-1.
It was really the odds were against him. I think if you're somebody who doesn't swear, that's a fair time to do it. You're 2-1. Yeah, they have twice as many guns, twice as many men. He's pushed across the river and is now isolated from reinforcements. So he's just got to dig his heels in and do kind of a really stubborn defense. And they, all credit to his men as well. They really pull it off.
Yeah, and then, you know, obviously they send Salt off.
As if the McCrispy couldn't get any better, Bacon and Ranch just entered the chat. The Bacon Ranch McCrispy, available at participating McDonald's for a limited time. Ba-da-ba-ba-ba.
We move on December 1813, we get into 1814, and I think Napoleon abdicates in April of 1814.
So Napoleon abdicates. News doesn't reach Wellington or Soult until a few days afterwards. Mm-hmm. So they still fight at Toulouse,
mm-hmm.
Which is, you know, really a toughly fought battle just outside the walls. Mm-hmm. And it finishes with Hill and Wellington kind of pushing the French back inside the town. Mm-hmm. Soult and his men abandon the town the next day. So both kind of achieve their aims to an extent. And that's where Wellington sends words to Soult to actually inform him that the war is over.
Mm-hmm.
As a point that I realized I didn't mention last time, Wellington, again, a man who doesn't show his emotion very well, when he receives word that Napoleon's abdicated and the war's over, apparently he clicked his fingers and spun around on his heels and shouted ole in celebration. So he's obviously picked up a little bit of like flamenco dancing in Spain.
I did not know that. That's very amusing. I've never heard that story. But so yeah, I guess, gee, our stories are over and Hill's all done, but no, that's not how it works, huh?
That's not how it works. We always end up with the bigger sequel here, don't we, to a story.
So where is Hill in the interlude while Napoleon's exiled in Elba?
He goes again back home. Mm-hmm. And he's actually, this is quite common at the time, he's a member of parliament. And then when he gets back, the rewards are put upon him, and he's elevated from the House of Commons to the House of Lords and is given his baronetcy, so he becomes Lord Viscount Hill.
Got it. And then our good chap Napoleon shows up out of nowhere and retakes the throne in 1815.
And Hill's there, as I say, as a right-hand man, and he's command of the second Allied Corps. So without diving down too much into it, the Anglo-Allied Army, the first corps is given to the Prince of Orange, who, how to be fair, has very little practical military command.
Well, he's a young man, right? He's very...
Yeah, he is. And he served on Wellington's staff in the peninsula, and he certainly studied war, which is what the monarchies did. You know, they studied, we've mentioned before we came on, Frederick the Great, and they would have probably studied Alexander and Marlborough, and they would have been... They're certainly doing debates about the American War of Independence and things like that.
Right.
And all of the geometry, trigonometry, etc. But he didn't actually have any practical real experience commanding, you know, brigades, divisions. And because of he was the prince and heir to the Kingdom of the Netherlands, Prince of Orange is given the first corps, the large unit, but Hill was given the second. Towards the end of the battle, you've got Prince of Orange is famously wounded near today's the Lion's Mound at Waterloo. Uxbridge is still there as the actual second in command. So the very difficult relationship because Uxbridge has run off with the Duke's sister-in-law. so the Duke's brother's wife.
Okay.
So they've got a very uneasy friendship.
Right.
He's there because he's good friends with the Prince Regent. And then Hill's there with two of his brothers, actually, so also serve at Waterloo. And that means that right at the end, if anything was to happen to Wellington from about 7 o'clock onwards, Prince of Orange is off the field and wounded. Uxbridge just lost his leg. So Hill's the actual second in command.
Hill's protecting the right side of the line, correct?
Yeah, so he's mostly got the right-hand side of Waterloo. Mm-hmm. He's got a really important job and a large force to do it as well.
Mm-hmm. And the quote I wrote down from Hill is that, I quote, "I verily believe there was never so tremendous a battle fought as that of Waterloo," which, end quote, which says everything, you know. And he was, correct me if I'm wrong, the general that asked the Imperial Guard of Napoleon to lay down its arms.
That's right. It's that kind of scene that in the 1970 film, they form square and they ask them to surrender. And in the film, they shout, "Merde." But in real life, as you know, it's more complicated than that.
Yep.
There was a rear guard action. Yep. Quite a lot were actually captured or melted away into the night. And then there was subsequent rear guard actions. But that was Hill. He was there. There's a beautiful painting of him inviting the old guard to surrender. And he went through that. They've said that the middle part of the battle, when the Grand Battery opens up, that it was the hardest pounding than they ever had. And that means they had more artillery on them there in that afternoon at Waterloo than in any point in the Peninsula War.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and just amazing, that battle. I mean, just the ebb and flow, it could have gone either way for sure.
And, he needed to be steadfast there. You've got men like Thomas Picton, who was suffering with shell shock or PTSD. And certainly his mental health was suffering. Yep. Maybe even Ney was. And these men had been through long campaigns.
Yeah.
And they had that that dangling promise of peace just above them in 1814, the summer of peace, where lots of society was celebrating. That's why there's so many people in Brussels.
Yeah.
Because they were trying to live, life in the moment. And he'd been through, he's been on campaign off and on since 1800.
Right. So
it's a long time to be away.
Yeah. So from there, obviously, Napoleon goes off to a second exile. And Hill is finally able to go into a non-military life, right? Does he becomes a politician? What happens to our good friend General Hill after this?
General Hill does actually really well. He's made governor of lots of towns, so that's like regional commanders of the military in the UK. He's given all sorts of awards from Austria, Russian, Britain and France. He's at the coronation of King George IV, who's the Prince Regent going on to become king. Mm-hmm. And he's right there with Wellington, who's also one of the great offices of state. He's in the procession there. And Wellington briefly, actually about 15 years, steps down as commander-in-chief. Mm-hmm. So that's the top of the armed forces, the army and the navy combined. Mm-hmm. And from 1828 to 1842, Hill steps into that role.
Interesting. Yeah. The only reason he doesn't go beyond 1842 is he passes that year, correct?
Yeah, so he serves until his death. He's 70 years old, and Wellington actually then comes back into the role, though he's really advanced in age. So Hill does a long stint in the top job. It's just not as well known. And so it's the time that the army should be reforming, and arguably doesn't reform that much, but it's overseas, and it's really one of the large parts of the British Empire is consolidating its power between India and Cape Colony and Africa and areas like that. So it's more of an administrative role and a head of, but he's there kind of controlling the armed forces.
Yeah, and then he was never married, didn't have kids, so did his titles pass on to someone?
Yeah, his titles passed on through his brothers.
Brothers, okay.
So he had, I think, three brothers, of which two were at Waterloo. Mm-hmm. I think at least Robert and I think, I want to say Thomas, two of his brothers are at Waterloo.
Oh.
And they pass on to his next brother. So the Viscount Hill passes on to them because it has to go through the male line.
Amazing that three brothers could get through the Peninsula War and Waterloo without, violent death. That's great.
It's pretty good odds, I think there were some minor injuries really at Waterloo for the other two, but he gets through it, apart from that one musket ball right back in Egypt. He's pretty unscathed through it.
That's amazing. Yeah, really interesting guy. I learned a lot about him just the past couple of days researching him, but like you said, like maybe one of the unheralded, underrated generals in the British Army.
And I think he was. I think he's a really interesting character. The fact that we don't know that much about him, he doesn't swear, his men really like him, that he's probably one of these people who's not shouting his own name from the rooftop.
Mm-hmm.
Not to name some other characters, but some people who want to be, not even just a household name, they want to be famous and have the glory. And I just don't get that feeling from his character at all.
Yeah, just, the way he took care of his men, the way he won consistently, it seems like he was focused on one thing, that was winning the war.
Just winning the war, doing right by his men. And I think that to me is a huge kind of like depth of gratitude right there.
Yeah, well, I like to learn more about him. Marcus, you were wonderful. I thank you for coming on the show and telling us all about General Hill. He was a really interesting guy.
He's a really good character. There's a quick book you can kind of get out there on him called Wellington's Right Hand. And that's by Joanna Hill. No coincidence. That's a kind of a family descendant.
Okay. Yeah, I might have to look
in. Recommend that one. That's definitely available online and all those good places.
All right. Well, yeah, again, thank you for coming on the show. You were brilliant as always. And yeah, let's talk soon. I love learning more about all the different characters and personalities in the British Army.
Oh, my absolute pleasure. I hope your listeners enjoy it.
Yeah, thank you.